Joining me now, Democratic Congressman Mike Quigley of Illinois. He sits on the House Intelligence Committee. Congressman, thanks for taking the time this morning.
Good morning, Jim.
As you know, the president, other U.S. officials have already publicly warned Russia not to invade Ukraine, as have U.S. allies. What different does Biden need to communicate on this call to Putin to deter an invasion?
Look, I think he needs to be clear that there's a unified front, that this will be extraordinarily costly if they invade. You know, I think they need to say, look, if you want Russian banks to be involved in the international system, if you don't want crippling sanctions against your oligarchs and other financial harm to Russia, you can't move forward on this. And I think what you're going to see is a give and take, because Putin has intentions of either invading or getting massive concessions to what he sees as threats to Russia.
As you know, since Russia invaded Ukraine already in 2014, and by the way, still controls territory there, Crimea, parts of eastern Ukraine, it's been under economic sanctions. Now, the administration is talking about stepping up those sanctions, for instance, denying access to the bond markets for U.S. energy, for Russian energy companies, or taking them out of what's known as the SWIFT international banking system. Would those new sanctions impose costs, in your view, sufficient enough to deter Russia, or do you believe Russia has said or decided those are costs we can bear?
You know, I don't think that they have. I think the fact that they haven't invaded so far at least tells us something that they're concerned about. What concerns me on the other side is, you know, how unified is NATO? How unified particularly is Western Europe? The Russians have always been opportunistic since, what, the Suez Crisis. And they see leadership changes in Western Europe. They know that winter is coming, literally, and from a political sense. And they know that Europe depends so much on their energy source. They're not afraid to use that. And the whole Pentagon Kremlin playbook is in play right now. Disinformation, cyber attacks, the use of energy as a coercive force. Those are all in play, and I think they recognize that if there's opportunity for weakness, it comes because of the need for energy.
Does Putin judge the U.S. in particular to be weak now, Biden to be weak, and do you think it was a mistake for the Biden administration not to sanction the Nord Stream 2 energy pipeline, perhaps as a signal to Russia of that weakness?
Look, I mean, there's a fine balance the Biden administration is trying to strike, and I think they've done very well so far. You don't want to be the appeaser, and you don't want to be that which provokes Putin to further action, including the invasion here. So I think you keep all those cards in play. And look, Congress plays a role, too. In the coming days, we will vote on the National Defense Authorization Act. And included in that are amendments dealing with this pipeline so important to Russia. So, you know, as I mentioned before, Germany, for example, has said don't sanction that pipeline because they need it. At the same time, their foreign minister has said that Russia will face extreme sanctions if they act. So they have to be unified. This has to all be in place. Congress and Biden the president have to work together with our allies. It's a very difficult balance at this point.
As your position on the Intelligence Committee, you are briefed regularly on U.S. intelligence regarding Russia's preparations and plans. I don't want you to get into classified intelligence here, but based on what you have seen, do you believe it is likely that Russia will invade Ukraine? And if it does, crucially, will it be a swift invasion?
You know, I think they're prepared for an extraordinarily swift invasion. If the spring bringing up of troops to the borders was a dress rehearsal, they're prepared for the final event here. They put everything they possibly can in place, and it is an extremely dangerous situation. You know, they're surrounded Ukraine on three borders. Again, the Kremlin playbook is in full play. They've done everything they possibly can, in my mind, to prepare as if they're going to invade, giving themselves that option if, again, the massive concessions I think they're going to want, those that will be wildly unrealistic, are not agreed to.
There is, of course, another military buildup around a sovereign country, and that is China's around Taiwan. Do you fear a possible double shot here, right, that Russia chooses to invade Ukraine and China perhaps at the same time or soon after, makes a similar judgment and invades Taiwan? Is that something that concerns you?
Yeah, you know, obviously, I think it should concern all Americans. It certainly concerns me. The second and third largest militaries in the world acting at the same time, they both have the advantage of what we'd call the home court advantage. They're there. Our armies and our allies aren't near there. It would take some time. So when I reference to what Putin would do is something of a modern-day blitzkrieg, it's concerning that China would do the same sort of thing, and again, opportunistically act as a duo, because what would we be able to do? What would our allies be able to do? It is the nightmare scenario.
A modern-day blitzkrieg on today's anniversary, World War II, a notable description.
Congressman Mike Quigley. The 30th anniversary of Ukraine's independence from the Soviet Union.
Exactly, which is something that, as you know, the former Soviet Union signed on to at the time. Congressman Mike Quigley, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.